leveraging the transformational power of vision. And, you know, the more I've thought about this and the more I've prayed about this, the more clearly it's showing to me that if there's anything that will transform, literally transform our lives, it is by leveraging the transformational power of vision. So if I am clear about vision and I am clear about what God is showing me or saying to me, it has the capacity to completely transform my life. So this morning, I'd like us to go over this journey in a very interesting way. So I first of all like to ask us a few questions. And the question I'd like us to answer before it shows on the slide is, what is vision? What does vision mean to you? Vision, anybody? When you hear vision, or what are you expecting this morning? Vision. Eh? When you sleep and something comes. Hallelujah. Anybody else? And so there's vision of the night and there's vision of the morning. What's the difference? What's the difference between vision of the night and vision of the morning? Okay, let's simplify it. If you have a vision, you have a vision. If you have a vision, say amen. Ah, people don't have vision, yo. If you have a vision, say amen. And so what's this vision? Which vision do you have? What does vision mean to you? Yes. A picture of the future that allows you to feature. Yes. It has to relate to seeing. Something about seeing. Okay? I saw another hand. Any other hand? Eh? Ahead. Okay? Now, I think, let's look at it very, you know, together very quickly. The dictionary defines vision as the faculty or state of being able to see. The ability to see. Vision is the ability to see. Say with me, ability to see. Ability to see. It says the ability to think about or plan the future with imagination or wisdom. So it's also the ability to create. So vision is the ability to think about the future and plan for it with wisdom and imagination, creative power. And those are verbs. And in the English dictionary, there's also a noun that is to imagine. This is what vision means in English language. I saw a very interesting definition of somebody who is like, who is a deviant, who is deviating from the normal context of how people define vision, who said, vision is the ability to close your eyes and imagine a future that does not exist, that does not yet exist. It is the ability to see beyond the mess that may be in front of you, to abstract away from it, clean it up, and see, hopefully, better, a future that does not yet exist. So saying that vision is not gain like that. You can close your eyes and imagine. And then you have vision. Now, one of the things I've learned that has also helped me is realizing that sometimes the dictionary definition is different from the biblical definition. Are we together? And sometimes when we use a word casually, the way the dictionary defines it, we may miss the value that God expects us to get from it. Example of those kind of words are words like love, which, when you look at it in the context of the extent to which God takes it, is more than the butterfly effects that a guy has for a girl. Love, in God's context, takes into consideration the eternal consequences of that relationship, goes beyond the feeling, is willing to sacrifice, and is defined by interesting characteristics that would have left out of love if defined by dictionary. In fact, the Bible says, love does not want what it does not have. Love does not strut. Love does not think about it. So, that sometimes, many times, the context of scripture is a lot different from the context that we find in the dictionary. And that's why it's important for us to sit down together like this and look at God's word together and say, what exactly does God mean about vision? Now, there was a verse we read this morning as we prayed. It's a very popular verse of scripture, Habakkuk chapter 2. And usually when there's a vision topic, that's the first verse that comes out. The vision, write down the vision and make it plain so that he that reads what may do what? May run. I'll ask you two questions. One, what does vision mean here? Two, what was God talking about here? What was the context of what was going on here? And is it really a special verse about vision? Or is there more to vision than this? Now, we're going to look at a few scriptures together. And what we're trying to decode from those scriptures is, what does vision mean here? And because we don't have all day, let's look at Habakkuk. You know, just take us to Habakkuk chapter 2 very quickly. He says, the Lord answered and said to me, write the vision and make it plain upon tables that he may read, that he may run that readeth it. Okay, verse 3. He says, the vision is for an appointed time, but at the end he shall speak, he shall not lie. Though he tarry, wait for it, because it shall come, it will not tarry. What was going on here? I hope you remember what was going on in this verse. Because we just, for many years, we just take this verse out of context and use it for vision. Oh, you read from chapter 1. If you read from chapter 1, you realize something very interesting is happening. So, God, Bible says, it starts with the burden which the prophet Habakkuk saw. And then he began a series of God's conversation with him, his conversation with God, saying, how long will I cry? How long will you not hear? How long will this happen? Terrible things were happening. And he said, look at the nations and watch. You know, and because I understand, God was talking to him, I will walk in your days, which you will not believe, though it were told you. For indeed, I am raising an army of people who will destroy my people. You know, sometimes when we quote that thing, we sound like it's a good thing that's going to happen after it. He's saying, I'm going to bring Babylonians, they're going to massacre the people. And he said, God, why will you do that? You're not serious, God. That's a conversation going on. And he says, are you not from everlasting? Are you not God, the only one? We shall not die. Oh Lord, you have appointed them for judgment. Oh Rock, you have marked them for correction. And he kept on this verse. And then he asked a question just before this narration. He says, you are treating men and women as like fish in the ocean. Why are you treating us like fish? You are pulling as in, are you going to let this go on and on? Will you let Babylonian fishermen fish like a weekend angler, killing people as if they are nothing but fish? That was the question. Then he says, what is God going to say to my question? I'm braced for the worst. I'll climb up to look to the lookout tower and scan the horizon. I will see what God says, how he'll answer my complaints. And then God answered and said this, write what you see. Write it out in big block letters so that if it can be read on the run, this vision message is a witness pointing to what is coming. It aches for the coming. It can hardly wait. And it doesn't lie. It seems slow in coming. Wait is on its way. It will come right on time. Now, so basically it was a conversation with God. And God was saying, look, you want an answer? I will show you. And what I will show you, when you get it, write it very boldly so that it is, even if you have to be running, you can still read it. Okay? What does vision mean here? Can anybody decode? What was the vision? What's the vision? What's the context of the vision in this case? What does vision mean in this case? You know, we said vision means ability to see. In English dictionary, we say it means the faculty of being able to think and plan for the future ahead. Yes? And we say it means to imagine. What does it mean here? Huh? What God said? God's insight. Like a revelation. Ah, this is a very intelligent class. Amen. Amen. Let's go forward. Where else can we see vision in the Bible? We can see vision in Genesis 13. In Genesis 13, we have God literally coming to meet with Abraham and give him a picture of what is possible for the future. In the same way we say about vision. And we have here in Genesis 13 verse 14. It says, and the Lord said to Abraham and Lot, after Lot had separated from him, lift your eyes now and look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, westward, for all the land which you see, I will give to you and your descendants forever. and I will make your descendants as the dust of the earth, so that if a man could number the dust of the earth, then your descendants also could be numbered. This was a conversation between God and Abraham. He told him, look all around you. As far as you can see, I'm giving to you. Is that a vision? Yeah? Is that a vision? Did Abraham see north, south, east, and west before God spoke to him? What changed? Oh, God's word is what made it change. Ah, amen. Let's go further a little bit. When he got to chapter 15 of same Genesis, Abraham was now complaining a bit and saying, ah, God, hey, all these very nice things you have promised me, is it this my servant that I am going to make it happen through? Verse 2, Abraham said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? Then Abraham said, look, you have given me no offspring. Indeed, one born in my house is my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this one shall not be your heir, but one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. Then he brought him outside and said, look now towards heaven and count the stars if you are able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. And he believed in the Lord, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Amen. Abraham had been seeing the stars, have you? So the vision cannot be that he saw stars. Because he joined his sisters, there are some boxers that can help you see stars. But the same thing that you just said now, what makes the difference here is God is saying, look, stop wallowing in where you are. Let me show you what is possible. Amen. Let's take it further. Our perfect example is Jesus. Did Jesus have a vision? Eh? What was the vision of Jesus? Salvation. Okay, so I'm trying to do very quick Bible study this morning. Hebrews 12. It says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising its shame. Amen. Who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising its shame, and has sat down at the right hand of God on the throne of God. Now, Jesus Christ had something that made him go through what he went through without shaking. What he had, the Bible describes it as the joy set before him. Say with me, the joy set before him. Now, what exactly does this mean? So I took the duty of giving us a few verses that shows this. It says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, our very popular one, KJV, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and he sat down the right hand of God and on the throne of God. Message says, keeping our eyes on Jesus, who both began and finished the race we are in, study how he did it. He says, because he never lost sight of where he was headed. Say with me, he never lost sight of where he was headed. Does that sound like vision? Does it sound like vision? He never lost sight of where he was headed. So, he didn't lose sight of where he was headed. That exhilarating finish in and with God. How did Jesus know where he was heading? Vision. And that vision, you said it means revelation. You said it means God's word. You said it means God's insight. So, of course, we know, ERV says, we must never stop looking to Jesus. He's the leader of our faith. And he's the one who makes our faith complete. He suffered death on the cross, but he accepted the shame of the cross as if he were nothing because of the joy he could see waiting for him. And now he's sitting at the right hand of God as prophesied. If you read Psalm 110 verse 1, you will see that if Jesus Christ has sat down and read Psalm 110, he knows that this is the end, and this is the pathway to that end, and that end I don't need to shake because I know where the end is. So very quickly, from our little discussion, we realize that the definition of vision in God's word is slightly different from the ability to see. It's more than the ability to see. That if you understand what vision actually means God's revelation. Or God's word. Or God's law. And a very, very popular verse of scripture, which we quote from the wisest man who ever lived before Jesus, is in Proverbs 29, verse 18. I'd like us to read that together. And then we'll close it from that space. It says, where there is no vision, people perish. Amen. And you know why we quote this verse? We stop there. Because somehow, for many of us, what comes next doesn't really make much sense. Where there's no vision, people perish, full stop. It's not full stop. It says, but he that keepeth the law, happy is he. So you ask yourself, what's the relationship between no vision and keeping the law? Now, today we understand that vision is revelation. We understand that vision is God's word. We recognize that vision is God's insight. We recognize that vision is God's law. So if you want to read this verse in context, if we go to a few other versions, we probably will see the bigger context of what God is sharing here. It says, New King James says, where there is no revelation, people cast off restraint. So the word vision has left that place and it has been replaced by revelation. It says, where there's no revelation, people cast off restraints. What's it saying here? What does it mean, people cast off restraints? It means where there's no revelation, people are not disciplined. Restraint means I have told myself I will not eat in the morning because of what I want to do this evening. I've told myself I will not go here and go here and go here. I will go here because of where I'm headed. But if I don't have exactly where I'm going, I will cast off the restraints and leave anyhow. You know, there are some children that will be running and running and running around. Promise that child and say, if you sit down in that place, I will give you biscuit, sweet, chewing gum, chocolate, cake. Just sit down in that place. If he's old enough to understand it, you will realize that some things are possible. Because every time he wants to stand up, he realizes. In fact, when he stands up and forgets that he stands up, and you look at him and say, I'm sorry, I forgot. It says, where there is no revelation, people live carelessly. Where there is no vision, and the vision here, we wrote clearly, revelation. It says, but happy is he who keeps the law. It still doesn't let you understand how the law applies. Abi, let's go a little further. It says, where there is no understanding of the word of the Lord, people do whatever they want to. But happy is he who understands, who keeps the law. Now, for those who have a revelation of God's law, who understand what God's word is doing, they are blessed. They don't just live anyhow. They don't do whatever they want to do. I like Amplified. It says, where there is no vision, in brackets, no redemptive revelation of God, the people perish. But he who keeps the law of God, which includes that of man, blessed, happy, fortunate to be enviable is he. And I like message. It says, if you can't see what God is doing, they stumble all over themselves. But when they attend to what he reveals, they are the most blessed. Ladies and gentlemen, there's a lot on the topic of vision. Do you have a vision for your life? Do you have a vision? Where are you going? What's the vision for your academics? Very, very solid conversations. But understand that the foundation of that vision is, what has God revealed to you? What have you found in God's word that you have owned? What have you found in meditating on scriptures as an insight that you have decided that this one, there's a sense of agreement between this scripture and me that it begins to show me a clear path for what is possible for me? Because if I don't have that clear revelation, then I'm likely to live anyhow. I had a very interesting definition, from someone, and I found very interesting, about the difference between visions and dreams. And, it was a quotation of Joel, I think it's Joel 2:28 now, where it says, When the Spirit of God comes upon you, he said the time is to come in. When the Spirit of God will come upon all flesh, and your old men will do what? Your old men will do what? Your young men will do what? Now, is explicitly defined as what will happen when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Amen. If the Holy Spirit has come upon you in this place, can you say amen?
Amen.
Now, so whether you are dreaming dreams or you are seeing visions is a function of your age. Amen. And in that context, when I was describing this word, I think I like that definition. He said a dream, the difference between a dream and a vision in that verse is that a dream is some picture of the future that a revelation of God that you have that may not be for your generation. Because you are old, you are likely to die before it happens. He said, well, if it's a vision, you are young, you are likely to make it happen or be a part of it happening. You know, when I heard that, I heard, I have a dream that one day, that was a dream. To say, one day, and it happened when a black person, for example, became president in America. That was a fulfillment of that dream, but it was an old man that dreamed that dream, even though he was less than 33. But he died not long after. So maybe it's not even really a function of age. So a dream is something that can transcend your own timelines. Whereas a vision is a revelation from God that you can take ownership of here and now. And as people who are filled by God's Spirit, our characteristic, our key identifier is that we either are dreaming dreams or seeing visions. And it's not because, listen, Peter was wide awake when he saw the vision of Cornelius. It was in the day. He didn't even sleep. He just saw it before him, a picture. And let me explain to you, in those days, there was no television. Television allows you to see vision on a telly. So he saw it live. He was like, eat and eat. I will not eat. He said, no, you have to eat. It was a day vision. Many of the prophets in the Bible got a revelation from God. You and I are so privileged that we have a document that shows us God's revelation for over the last 6,000 years. And God doesn't change. And God doesn't change his. He doesn't give up on anything. God's love is so consistent. God is so consistent. The same yesterday, today, and forevermore. I can take his promises from any time and find cohesion in those promises. And now that I realize that vision is not something I need to close my eyes to see, I need to go to bed to see, I need to pray for a dream. Sometimes it happens to me. So then I pray, and I feel like, after this prayer, let me just sleep so that I can see a vision. No. You want to get clear insight into what is God doing? What is God's word saying? Because guess what? When you are not clear about what God's word is saying, we will stumble over ourselves. But once we have that clear revelation, happy are we. Enviable are we. How does this vision transform us? How does it transform us? One, we've seen from that verse, it constrains us. If I know that this is what God has opened my eyes to see, and let me tell you, if I ask you, come and lead prayer now, there are some verses of scripture you are very comfortable with. Amen. I hope so. I hope there are some verses of scripture you are very comfortable with because they are like a recurring decimal in your life. You keep going back there. You keep going back there so much that it's as those scriptures were written for you. And it's probably revelation that you have. It's revelation that God has opened your eyes to see because it connects with something he wants to use you to do. I wish I had time. I will ask you for your verse. I know the verses that come to me. Now, what you have all over scripture is revelation. The Bible says the things that are revealed, they are the ones that belong to us. The ones that are not revealed, they are for God. And you know, we said that there are levels. And those levels are not defined by God. If you say smash the sword, smash the spears, and you smash it three times. If you say borrow vessels, and you borrow vessels a few. It's when a vessel finish, The miracle finishes. You determine how far. And that God's word is there. The revelations are there. It constrains us. I remember as a teenager, I'll tell you something very interesting. As a teenager, I had some advances and opportunities that were sexual in nature. The only reason I did not go ahead was I told myself, when I am telling my story, I will not like to talk about this one. I had a vision of my future. I had a revelation about my future that I will be important. I will be the kind of person who is talking, addressing people. And how, honestly, I couldn't find scripture. It was, how will I say it? How will I talk about it? So I said no. Because I couldn't find it fitting into the future that I saw. I remember as a young person, my friends would ask me, do you know why you're selling bread and akara? And I will smile. I'll say, one day, when I talk about this, it will sound strange because I will have moved very far away from this place. That back in those days, the people that we knew their names, I had the person sold newspaper, the person sold this, the person sold this, but now the person is a successful person. I'm forming my own stories because I know where I am going. I'm talking about 14, 15, 16. 16, 17, I was barbing hair. I could barb hair without shame. Because I know it won't define me. I'll get past this place. And it will be a very good story to tell. Vision constrains us. Bible says, for lack of revelation, people perish. It means people can die. You know, somebody said sometime back many years ago, he said, and it sounded funny, but it has some air of truth in it. He said, the way I stay alive is by having a vision for tomorrow. Because you are not qualified for a tomorrow you cannot see. So people say, I will die today if I can't see tomorrow. So you set a goal for tomorrow. I say, so tomorrow I will do this one, I'll do this one, I'll do this one, I'll do this one, so that God will preserve my life tomorrow. If you don't have revelation about what is next, you are not qualified to be there. It keeps us alive. It keeps us committed. Are there going to be setbacks? Oh, yes. Will things always go smoothly? No. But because you have revelation, you will tell yourself, no, no, no. I will stick to it until we get there. Everybody has setbacks. Everybody faces challenges. Everybody you look at today and you feel, successful person, has had setbacks that could have made them stop. You know, I stumbled on a video yesterday. And the reason why I watched it because I was tripped that the video was recorded 2 months ago. It was a small interview that Fidelity Bank did for Obi Kubana 2 months ago. So they were asking him, how does somebody build a billionaire business, those kind of things. And that's a very, very interesting question. He said, have there been times when you felt like, this is not working, let me quit? He said, plenty of times. He said, that's normal now. It's normal. He said, in fact, some years ago, it was so bad, he decided to go and get visa to South Africa. But they didn't give him. That's the only reason he's still in Nigeria. He said, they didn't give him visa. He said, he tried visa to different places. He said, South Africa, they didn't give him. And then he asked himself, all the things I always want to achieve, I've always dreamt about, they are available in this country. So he gathered himself again and said, you know what? Let's do this. Ladies and gentlemen, people will have setbacks. Vision, revelation, word from God will keep you committed. It will help your decision-making process. So sometimes I talk with Pastor Bakari and he says, they gave me oil well, but I have returned it. I asked them to make sure that they sign for it, that they received it back. And someone said, that is $3 million per day. And he said, what if I die after 2 days when I collect it? Then it's $6 million. And that's the end. He said, somebody said, you have just passed the ultimate temptation. He said, no, I don't feel tempted at all. Why? Because I know what God has shown me. Like, Joseph is a good guy. He didn't sleep with Potiphar's wife. No, it's revelation. Revelation is what will not let you have erection in the wrong place. Because you realize, no. What God has promised me, this doesn't look like it. Doesn't smell like it. Doesn't taste like it. Doesn't look like any way that will lead to it. Revelation. It's God's vision. It will help your discernment. You will know when to say yes. You know when to say no. This is not for me. Because God has shown me in his word that this is my portion. It emboldens us. You know, sometimes you're like, why are you not? No, you will take a firm line, you'll be emboldened in that line because you know. It also galvanizes us. When I see that where you are going and where I'm going is tied together, then we're galvanized, we work together. When it is God's agenda that drives both of us, we'll be united. Let us be united. It's a joke. Let us united, we'll never be united. Yeah, let's come together. It's for a while. The only togetherness that will last forever is when we recognize that there is something revealed to all of us that is bigger than all of us that brings us together. And that's why every time I hear a vision about Nigeria and God shows somebody and says, you're going to self-destruct if you separate because this, you are better together. My plan for you is to be together. I prize that over any feeling. It emboldens us. And guess what? Vision turns us into completely new people. Our salvation is a function of a revelation. Bible says, I was thinking that they would say Abraham believed that Jesus was going to come. No. Bible says Abraham believed in the Lord and it was counted to him for righteousness. What did he believe? He believed that even though he was 100 years old, he would give birth to his son because God says so. The Bible says in Galatians that the gospel was preached first to Abraham. So Abraham received and believed in God and he became the father of all those who will enter into God's genealogy by faith, by believing God's revelation. Ladies and gentlemen, don't wait for God to speak to you audibly. He's already in his word. He just needs for that which is in his word to jump out to you, be real to you, and how will that ever become a possibility? One, you will keep God's word consistently around and before you. Amen. You will meditate on it day and night. Ladies and gentlemen, this God's word is a treasure chest of revelation. And you can choose your level. You can choose the level you want to operate. You can say, the Bible says, the poor you will always have with you. And make that your own confession. That this one, they said the poor always be here. I receive this one. That I don't, all those words annoys me. I like poverty. Because there's provision for it. They will always be available with you. Or you can say, me, I want to be single. Because the Bible says marriage is not for everyone. It's for mature people. It says it requires a grace and an attitude. And anybody who can mature into, it says anybody who can enter into the majority and largest of marriage should do it. But me, I cannot. So I accept the one that is available for me. I want to be single. But I want to be a successful single. There's provision for it. Oh, I don't need to have children. I can adopt. Oh, there are many provisions for different things here. You choose out of the bouquet and the buffet that's available in God's word by revelation. You can choose. You know, I was having a discussion recently about the difference between free will and independent will. Topic for another day. There's a difference. What God gives us is not independent will. We have free will. But it's different from independent will. Independent will is what we source for ourselves. We'll talk about that another day. But ladies and gentlemen, you need to seek him as a treasure. If you look at God's word, God's revelation, God's law, it's embodied in a person, Jesus Christ. He is the word of God. When God wanted to reveal himself in human form, it was Jesus. Are we together? That if you find in Jesus Christ, you find the template of what our best life can be. We need to make Jesus our standard and our script. And daily practice meditating on God's word. Why? Because it's as we meditate on God's word that the light hits us. You know, I was excited to read the story of Martin Luther, the reformer. He spent eight years studying Romans, reading it. After 8 years, one day, it just hit him. Bah! The just shall live by faith. One verse. That one verse, when he got the revelation of it, he scattered the Catholic Church. One verse, Romans 1:17. He took his document. We don't need to pay for our sins. No. That sense of guilt I felt for the last 8 years, there is no way to rid myself of it except I accept the gift of God's salvation made available to me. And that was how Protestants started. One revelation. Somebody got the revelation of God's word and realized Gentiles need to be added to this thing. And it became their life mission. And in order for it to have roots, Peter also got a glimpse. Ladies and gentlemen, if you catch a revelation of what God's word is saying, it will make your life different. It will make you a whole new entity, a whole new individual. You'll be a new creation. But light shines when we spend time in God's word. Let us pray.